How's everyone doing? Good? Good?
Grab some candy. The sheets are the same thing as New York, so whatever works for you.
You know Ben Lott?
That's my son-in-law.
keep that in mind. It's he has a plus, but you know, hey, he has a plus. So the rest of the sign-up sheets, I ran out, maybe she'll have more. So if you do us a huge favor and go ahead and fill those out, make sure you grab, if you don't have one now, just grab one on the way out. That way it gives us an opportunity to keep in touch with you even after this presentation. Okay, so my name is Brad, and I'm with Stephen Associates. I actually brought my daughter here tonight, Jalen. She's going to be running the camera. Well, kind of runs itself now. So we're happy to be here, and like I said, once again, thank you for your time. So I bet you're wondering why I'm here and why we're all here. Why is a bunch of old guys here to talk about money? But who are we? We're Stephen Associates, and that's why we're here. We have a long connection with Lipscomb University. Our founder, Dan Stephen, is an alumnus of Lipscomb. His wife, Nancy, works in the PA department, that's physician assistants. My wife, Jamie, attended the academy here, K through 12. And my infamous father-in-law taught organic chemistry here for 40 plus years. We sponsor a suite at Allen Arena, and there we pack it out with even more old people who scream at the basketball game. But tonight we're here because we want to be. Heck, it's Lipscomb, okay? Nashville. Who wouldn't want to come here and hang out? Our mission, to increase and protect your assets, increase your savings with liquidity, reduce your risk, lower your income taxes, and provide you with an exit strategy at retirement. Plain and simple, we want you to gain wisdom, be successful, and acquire wealth. Now, what does that mean? I don't know. We have a marketing guy who writes this stuff. He does a lot of things like that. But it simply states that we help people get where they want to be. Everyone wants this. Everyone wants to be a part of what we do. So we are introducing it to you now, because there's a lot of deception out there. Our job is to get you through that deception. We model our clients' financial plans. We incorporate every possible area financial decision making. It's all in the model. Car insurance, property insurance, medical insurance, just to name a few. We teach our clients how to save and where to save. We will teach you. Does anyone know how much to save? Anybody here? Someone said, how much of your money are you saving? Which, does anyone have an answer of how much to save?
Zero.
Close. Close. Definitely close. Anyone else? How much should you save? How much?
About 10.
About 10? Close. Okay. Perfect. So we're not going to get into that tonight, but these are the things that we teach as you become a client at Stephen Associates. Then we teach our clients how to grow their money with investments. We teach them where to invest. We also teach our clients more of these common services that we cover. This is who we are, and this will be the reason why we're very valuable to you. All right, so coming up next, we're gonna show you a very short video from our website that helps explain and visualize what steps we take with our clients.
So much has changed over the past 10 years that many of the plans we made still aren't the same as they once did. The reason is that we are all making financial decisions independently, and people don't realize how these decisions might impact one another negatively. Making decisions in this manner results in second thing you'll need is a financial rulebook. A financial rulebook will teach you how to make financial decisions and to avoid the transfer of wealth problem. We'll go back to the transfer of wealth problem later on. We use the strategic allocation problem, which covers the rules for building, protecting, enjoying, and passing on your wealth. The third tool is a virtual model. The virtual model lets you see the impact of your decisions before you make them. Using personal financial movies allows us to show you how various strategies might play out. The fourth need is a macro manager. In order to make successful financial decisions, you need to do business throughout your life with lots of different professionals, such as a real estate agent, banker, life and health insurance agents, an attorney, a money manager, a PNC agent, business partners, and an accountant. But what you really need is a macro manager, and that's where we come in. As the macro manager, we are uniquely positioned to coordinate with your other advisors, or in other words, to macro manage them. It's like getting all of those advisors into one room at the same time, working together on your behalf. It's not that we recommend changing your trusted advisors, we want to help you coordinate with them. Finally, the fifth principle is the best money strategies to overcome the pesky transfer of wealth problem. The transfer of wealth problem is where money is systematically transferred and voted away. But how and to who? Every day, there are three outside groups fighting for each one of your dollars. The government takes their bite from taxes. Financial institutions like banks, brokerage houses, and insurance companies have costs and fees associated with everything they offer. And corporations manufacture products and technology for you to spend your $100 on. Then there's you, the consumer, trying to hold on to as much money as possible. It often seems like a couple struggle, since it's the consumer alone that pays for the other three sectors of the economy. What you need to do first is identify your specific situation so you can make the best decisions for you. When working together, we will start with a focus on four initial objectives. We will utilize resources to help create more wealth and greater enjoyment. We will provide better protection against wealth erosion without adding risk or even often lessening your risk, and all the while without interrupting your financial lifestyle. Our main goal and purpose is to create a greater money supply and benefits to you, to supplement, not to reduce your lifestyle. When we work together, we'll take a look at your entire financial picture, pinpoint any deficiencies, and make recommendations. Financial planning can't be done in a day, and we see a financial plan as an ever-adjusting work in progress. Now, how about we gather some more information that will allow us to start working toward developing your financial future?
So when Morgan and I got together and discussed what we believed would be a great topic to start an educational platform suited for you, we thought budgeting would be a great place to start. So tonight we're going to explain what it means to have a budget and why it's so important. What is a budget? This is Webster's Dictionary's definition of what a budget is. But basically, a budget is a decision. It's a decision of many decisions. It is your decision on how you accept money, spend money, and save money. I added this picture to show what a college student's inflow and outflow may look like. You always want your inflows to be more than your outflows. Just like here at Lipscomb, the university wants more money coming in than what's going out. So that way the university can buy better sports equipment and get more money in scholarships. All right, what you've all been waiting for. Tonight's key points for success. All right, we're gonna go over these in order of how to set a budget. Center your attention. Everyone wants your money. And don't forget to have fun. All right, first down, how to set the budget. All right, the first thing you want to do is to calculate your income. The foundation of an effective budget is your net income. Does anyone know what net income is? I say net or take home pay. Does anyone understand that? Okay. And so if you get a check, you know, or you work a job and you make $300, and then your check says $200 because you pay taxes and Social Security and things like that. So the $300 is your gross pay, okay? And your net pay is $200. All right, and it's coin take home pay. I know everyone here this probably has a different financial situation, scholarships, stipends, parents. There's all sorts. So, but take home pay is what you see in your bank account, no matter how it got there. Okay, your income is how that money gets in your bank account. So focusing on your total salary or your gross income, because you will think you have more available to you, could get you in a budget trouble. Alright, tracking your spending. Once you know how much money you have coming in, the next step is to figure out where it's going. Tracking and categorizing your expenses can help you determine what you're spending the most on and where it might be easiest to save. Begin by listing your fixed expenses, those that may change from month to month, such as groceries, gas, and entertainment. This is an area where you might find opportunities to cut back. Credit cards and bank statements are a good place to start since they often itemize or categorize your monthly expenditures. Record your daily spending with anything that is handy, a pen and paper, an app on your smartphone, or budgeting spreadsheets or templates found online. So it really doesn't matter. As long as you're keeping track of this stuff, whatever your style is, it's called a budgeting style. Whatever it is, just have a style. Set realistic goals. Okay, before you start sifting through your information you have tracked, make a list of short and long-term financial goals. Short-term goals should take around 1 to 3 years to achieve and might include things like setting up an emergency fund or paying down a credit card debt. Long-term goals, such as saving for retirement or your child's education, may take decades to reach. Remember, your goals don't have to be set in stone, but identifying them can help motivate you to stick to your budget. For example, it may be easier to cut spending if you know you're saving for a vacation. Number four, make a plan. This is where everything comes together. What you're actually spending versus what you want to spend. Use the variable and fixed expenses you compile to get a sense of what you will spend in the coming months. Then compare that to your net income and priorities. Consider setting specific and realistic spending limits for each category of expenses. To help track spending, our clients use a cash flow analysis worksheet. You'll want to use this worksheet. Can anyone here give an example of a fixed expense? Yes. Close. Rent. Yep. Real estate. Home and rental. What about discretionary expenses? What about that? So at this age, you got a lot of discretionary expenses. Okay? Discretionary expenses, personal care, health club, beauty, vacation, entertainment. Okay? Discretionary expenses. Things you spend money on but you don't necessarily have. Okay, this worksheet helps you work through all those things, puts everything on one page so you can see and track where your money is going. All right, second base, center your attention. To help track spending, now that you've documented it, you can make any necessary adjustments so that you don't overspend and have money to put towards your goals. Look towards your wants as the area that you make cuts first. Can you skip movie night in favor of a movie at home? Remember, even small savings add up to a lot of money. You might be surprised how much extra money you accumulate by making one or two minor adjustments at a time. You want to review your budget regularly. Once your budget is set, it's important to review it and your spending on a regular basis to be sure you're staying on track. A few elements of your budget are set in stone. You may get a raise. You may get a scholarship. Your expenses may change. Your goals might change. Maybe you reached a goal and you want to plan for a new one. Whatever the reason, get in the habit of regularly checking with your budget, following the steps we have given you. All right, I want everyone up here, and I want you to repeat these words with me. Everyone.
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 There you go. I know it's late. Once.
Once.
My.
My.
Money.
Money.
Everyone wants my money.
Everyone wants my money.
And they do. Okay? This is one of the important reasons why we're here. I know some of this stuff is a little, okay? But now we're really going to get into why we're here, especially with our Lipscomb student athletes. With a whole new breed of intense marketing techniques drawing students that are at college, who often are the target demographic for many new products, being aware of these advertising techniques can help you stick to your budgets and avoid overspending. So you're living in a time of unmeasurable marketing opportunities. Okay? Years ago, there was newspapers, maybe a commercial here and there, but now every corner you take is a marketing opportunity. On a college campus, since you're all so close-knit, it's very easy for companies to come in and market to you. The three main concepts that are focused on in advertising are the message, the people in the ads, and where the ads are being placed. If you're talking to young adults like yourself, you would use people in the ad in the ads that look their age so they seem like they're in college too. So when you see commercials that are targeted towards you, it'll be people of your same age, okay, doing the same types of things. Placement of advertising is also important for companies who are using college students as their target market. Companies place ads for their products on media that a lot of students will be exposed to, including baseball games, social media, things of that nature, Google ads, things of that. You're always going to see these things coming at you. The ability to dissect and process advertising messages is a key step in the purchase decision. College students must be mindful that their ads are normally meant to generate a financial exchange. So I'm going to repeat that. You have to be mindful that ads are normally meant to generate a financial exchange. So when a company markets to you, they're not trying to inform you, they're not trying to make you smile, they want your money. The end goal is to have a financial exchange between you and them, where it's you giving them your money. So at the end of the day, you can make the best decisions if you are an informed consumer. And that's one of the biggest reasons we're here today, is to educate and inform. All right, credit. So I'm going to touch a little bit on credit and credit cards. Banks seek out customers who have never had a card. College students are among the most prominent targets for this marketing. So 18 years old is the threshold to get a credit card. So incoming freshmen, sophomores, you're in that realm, 18, 19 years old, where you're going to start getting, I'm sure, mailers, opportunities to get a credit card. And they are young and understand that they need credit to get ahead in the world. And that's what you're taught. You're taught that, hey, I need to establish credit. I need to do these, you know, do this to get credit. They seem nice and sparkly when you see them. But all those things aren't necessarily true, especially at this age. Okay? Some think they need credit cards because of the rising cost of college education. Okay? With these things in mind that are in the back of your brain, this is what makes you an easy target. Because you're thinking, all right, I got this, I got that, I got this expense, I got this expense. And then someone shows up and says, hey, I'll give you a $10,000 credit limit. You're like, solve my problems right there. Here you go. Okay? And that's how it starts. And then once you start that process, it becomes easier and easier to be marketed to. Those companies use a variety of techniques, from buying lists from schools and entering into exclusive marketing arrangements with schools to market directly to students through the mail, over the phone, on bulletin boards, and through aggressive on-campus, near-campus tabling. So raise your hand if you've seen one of those credit card tables on campus. You seen one? That's great. So Lipscomb must be doing a lot of betting to keep them up. So normally you would see on a college campus, they'll have these tables set up, says Bank of America. And you walk over and you got two or three people and they got free stuff. They got stuffed animals, koozies, those water bottles that leak, okay? All those different things. Same thing when you go by like an AT&T or, you know, Costco, and they always stop you, who's your cable provider? It's the same thing. So, and they do that, and they entice you with the free gifts to have you come over and talk, offer you a credit card, okay? So we wanna make sure that we keep that in mind, and that's something that we teach our clients also. Fourth quarter, don't forget to have fun. Entertainment is crucial in college. As they say, there's no better time in life than the time you spend in college. You meet new people from different parts of the world. There are numerous opportunities to make your life better when you leave. And not forgetting the freedom. There's no one monitoring you and controlling what you do. Kinda, Mormon. For this reason, there's no limit to fun things you can do. Unfortunately, entertainment in college has a price tag. Chick-fil-A, okay. Combo meal is what, 10 bucks, 11 bucks? Starbucks, 6 bucks, 7 bucks, depending on if you get whipped cream or not. And somebody help me pronounce this word, Adamez? Okay. Oh, see, I knew you knew that one, yeah. Yeah, I was recently informed about this one. $40,000 handbags, $900 ashtrays, things like that. So you want to have fun, but you want to make sure and understand that that fun could have a price tag, like some of these items here. Chick-fil-A and Starbucks, not so much, but if it's three or four times a week, those things will add up. Fortunately, there are plenty of entertainment options you can take advantage of without money. And we're going to just go through a few of them. College-sponsored events are an excellent example of free entertainment. In most cases, these events will be on campus, or the school will provide transport to a given location. Is that any? Do you see any of that here, Tristan? Do you see any kind of campus events? Like they say, hey, come on down, get some lemonade. Anything like that?
Yeah.
No, you guys study all day? I mean, study.
Practice,
then study. Perfect. Because these events are designed with students in mind, there's no doubt you'll have tons of fun. Practice. All right, one excellent way to find free entertainment is obviously through social media. So if you ever have time between practice and class, always check Facebook, Instagram, and things like that. There's tons of free events in your area. We live in one of the best cities in America. Music City, right? It's always live venues, free stuff. Up and coming artists are trying to make it, so they play for free. Things of that nature, okay? In most cases, these are events are either free or really cheap. Student discounts. Does anyone go anywhere that has a student discount? Shoe stores or clothing stores, they offer student discounts? Do y'all take advantage of any of those? Except other than like the student store. Is there anyone else? They've done away with that, right? Okay. Well, if you do find one, make sure you shop around to find it, because in your age group, it's just like now you get student discounts. When you're 65 and 70, they give you, have you heard of a senior discount? It's the same thing. You just get it on the front end, you get it on the back end. Sometimes you can get these on food, clothing, and other items. All right, so before you pull out your wallet, always find out on Google if there are student discounts in your area. So you can just type in student discounts in my area, Nashville, Tennessee, things like that. Those discounted stores should come up. All right, the other thing that might be popular is Uber and Lyft. All right, there's nothing wrong with these rider apps, okay? They're not used too often, because I took an Uber about a month ago to the airport, and it was like $75, all right? And I live like 14 miles from the airport. But it was because of the time I took it, type of car that was available, etc. So, okay? All right, one way to get your finances back in order is to have a priority list, okay, of what things that you do. So you might want to take advantage of maybe a ride share with a friend, but you can still use Uber, and especially those opportunities where if it's 2 o'clock and you got a friend's house and you got to get back to campus, I don't want you walking, all right, call an Uber and things like that, all right? So be smart. Attend citywide events. Once again, touched on it, you live in one of the best lively cities in America. There's tons of events. These are also entry free, quite low expense wise. This is the perfect mix for a student on a budget. However, one of the reasons why entertainment is so cheap that it's sponsored by city vendors. So it goes back to what we just talked about being targeted. So anytime there's a free event, and you'll see it says sponsored by Coke, sponsored by Sprite, sponsored by whoever. When you see that sponsored by sign, those companies will have people on the inside of these free events marketing to you. So that's another avenue that they use. They want to get as many people inside so they can sell the products. Therefore, you need to be careful about impulse buying. Okay, so how many times have you been to a free event and you go to get a Coke and it's $6? Right? And you're like, oh, I'm here. And how many times do you say this? I mean, I'm guilty of it all the time. How many times do you go in and say, well, I got it for free, so I'll buy the $6 Coke? Right? I mean, it happens all the time. Well, I got in for free. She's like, no, that's good. Well, I got in for free, so if it costs me $10, I can spend $6 on Coke. But that's exactly why they sponsor these events. So you want to be careful about impulse buying because it can take your budget through the roof. Have fun without spending money you don't have. As you can see, you don't have to have a fortune to afford entertainment in college. There are multiple ways to get free events and affordable entertainment spots around Nashville. And I wrote this before I was talking to you today, and it seems like it's going to fit perfectly. So don't spend all your time working on essays and going to practice. Once in a while, putting on your dancing shoes and having fun without blowing your budget. All right, how's everyone doing? Good? I told you I wouldn't keep you too long. Oh, not yet. But we're getting close. We're getting close. Okay. So to summarize this evening, I'm not going to go back over what we've already talked about. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to add one final piece, and it's one of the things that kind of takes the whole presentation and puts it into one main point while we're here tonight and what we want you to take away from this presentation. What does it mean to be financially educated? Being educated means you have an understanding in a few core areas. Budgeting to manage your money, setting financial goals, saving money, and being educated on credit cards. Financial education is not something you will magically know, and that's why we're here. The majority of schools are not teaching personal finance to students. There's a major lack in financial education. So unless you're taking economics courses and things of that nature that would touch on finance and things like that. But even those classes, economics and business finance classes, they don't really touch on personal finance. And that's why it's important, and that's why we're here, because in a broader scope, those things don't really fit into a personal budget. So we want to make sure that you understand that some of those finer things are going to be found in something that we can do here for you. All right, you may have parents and family that were misinformed or lack a deeper knowledge that you can't learn from. So I know my father, he was a cash guy, he spent cash. He didn't know what a checking account was, he didn't know what, you know, credit cards were, you know, about saving and anything like that, and I just pay cash. So, and that's someone that, if I didn't seek the advice of a financial planner, that's what my theory would be, because we learn everything, not everything, but the majority of things from our parents. So what are you going to do? How are we going to, you know, change this? So it's just like when you walk into a biology class. There are things you know about science, but it will never be the knowledge you get from a teacher who has dedicated his life to educating students. You picked Lipscomb, because you wanted the best education. Use that same thought process when choosing a financial planner.